Raffaele Gallo, historic presents on the collapse of walls.
Thank you. Welcome, and also I am Rafaela, and I'm coming from the University of Norway. It's called NTNU. I'm working as an associate professor at the Department of Physics in the group of material theory. So what I do is I do molecular simulations, and today I will show you some modeling that we have done on the cavitation. We'll explain a bit the concept of cavitation, why it's important to study cavitation, and in particular the cavitation due to ultrasounds. I will give some results of a recent paper. So first of all, I would like to introduce very briefly what I do. I do usually molecular simulation, Monte Carlo, so classical methods, and I apply that to different systems, so protein system, but now with my PhD, we are doing some nucleation of biominerals. We are also doing some glasses with my master's students. And I'm still finishing, wrapping up some work on thermal conductivity for MOF, metal organic frameworks, with the group of Berensmith and EPFL. So today I will speak to you about cavitation. It is a very recent work that I've done. So the cavitation is the phenomena for which there is a formation, a growing, and a collapse of bubble in a liquid state. So let's consider that this formation of bubble, growing and collapse happens because of the action of a pressure wave. I will speak, and I am modeling in this work, a kind of cavitation that is called inertial cavitation, meaning that this cavitation will generate shock wave. So this is a model of the process in general. So basically, as you know, a pressure wave is just a series of compression and rarefaction. So when the ultrasound is actually applied to a liquid state, the pressure of the liquid is going down lower to the vapor pressure of the water, and then is forming cavity or bubbles, the one that I will call bubbles. Then in a second stage, this bubble is equilibrating, and because of going from negative pressure to positive pressure, then the bubble is actually imploded and squished. And then this implosion causes a very particular state, a plasma state, that is characterized by very high temperature and very high pressure. So this process is very well known for very long time, and is a technological problem for the propeller of the boat, in the sense that when the implosion happens in close to one metal surface, the high condition can generate microjets that are actually damaging very strongly the metal surfaces. So this is an experimental paper from some group of scientists that have studied the effect of one bubble explosion it's a very critical things. So and the effects are very old, in the sense that is known from Eulero and Reynolds' book about this effect. The physics behind is now we know something, but still the details are very unknown, and especially is very difficult to control the mechanism. So sonication is actually the cavitation generated by ultrasound, meaning by frequency of wave pressure that are bigger than 20 kilohertz, and certain experimentalists can actually reach frequency of megahertz, so 20 megahertz. It depends really by the application. This is a typical scheme of an experimental setup when you have an intersonic generator that is generating waves in a liquid setup with a sample, and then you find some application in, I'm sure you have been exposed to some medical treatment with low frequency ultrasounds, for example. There are very interesting applications, like for example in bio-nanotechnology, ultrasound is used to break the cell wall to extract protein from the cell membrane. But also in food, there are some, if you look just in internet very quickly, you will find that some certain company is selling the service to purify or to clean food in the food industry, or to accelerate or to retard the thawing or the freezing. So it's a very, it's already commercial, the technology. In medicine, there is a very interesting phase for this, for the for the treatment, for the diagnosis, is used routinely. For cosmetic, is used routinely, for example, to burn the fat. But in medicine, for example, the idea is, really to encapsulate the drug, to be able to put the drug in the liquid in the patient, and with the ultrasound and other combination, technical combination. So the idea is really to make the bubble explode and to use the energy in a particular time and in a particular, in a very local target. So the application of these are very big in a lot of fields. We have also characterization and production application. So it's also used in cement or in a lot of material. For example, there is another branch of ultrasound frequency that goes from 20 kHz to 100 kHz that is used to detect microfracture or void or crack in without really to destroying the sample. So it's is used in a lot of technology, and now is very well known that is helping the mixing and the mixing of cementitious material, is helping with the hydration, and some company are using that. MAPEI, some other big company is actually using that as to create cement. And apparently it does help increase the performance of the material in terms of strength. The idea of this research was how we can use cavitation for our application. So can we really trick a little bit the physics to make it work for our application? So the idea is, can I change, for example, the solvent in a way that I move the area of interest of my bubble formation, for example? I have done, this work is done introducing ionic liquids inside the water. So I am, the ionic liquids are basically, it's a very simple, it's a salt. There is two ions, positive and negative ions, that are in a liquid state when at a temperature that is lower than 100 degrees Celsius. So ionic liquids are interesting because they are many. So you can have million compounds, you can combine in a lot of ways. So they have a huge application in medicine, and then a lot of, and it's very cheap also to produce. So it's something that, it's very promising. So the idea is, can we use ionic liquids to change the property of the liquid to prevent the corrosion, or even to exploit the corrosion in certain cases, or to use the catalytic properties in the plasma region? Or the other idea is really to improve the actual idea of encapsulating drugs and releasing at a certain point in a certain place. Also, there is a very high level idea of using this very localized energy to break bonds and to create nanoparticles that are very expensive to create in other ways. So there are many, many applications. And here I do a modeling study. So I'm applying molecular dynamics to study the effect that ionic liquids changing solvent has on the formation of bubble. So I'm doing three series of simulation, one in pure water, one in one ionic liquid that is called tetraethanol ammonium mesylate. It's a very complicated name, but what you have to remember that this is hydrophobic, hydrophilic compound, means that it really likes water, and in water it's forming a very homogeneous liquid. Then I will, then I've done a series of simulation with tetrabutyl phosphonium DMBS. And you have to remember that this is amphiphilic. What does it mean? It has one hydrophobic head and hydrophilic tail. And so what's happened is, this is a typical sample. These are some simulation technique. I've used details. I've used Gromax. I use some empirical force field. Gromos 54A7 is the parametrization for the ions. The force field for the water is the SPCE. And then to simulate the action of the ultrasounds, I use constant pressure simulation, sudden constant pressure simulation, or constant volume simulation. And to control the temperature, I use the Nuse-Hoover thermostat. To control the pressure, I use the so-called Parinello-Raman thermostat. I have managed to run samples that reach the size of 600,000 atoms. So these are atomistic simulations. So every, it's an atom. It's a very atomistic simulation. And this is due to, I've been able to run in very short time only because I was using a cluster. It's a GPU cluster in Switzerland that gave me the hours because of the price grant. It's very important to describe the assumptions of this work. I'm looking at frequencies of sonication that do not go over 10 to 2 kilohertz. What does it mean? It means that the period of my wave is of the order of 1 microsecond. So if at the beginning my wave is actually inducing the formation of the bubble because it's going to positive to highly negative, and the other way, there is a lot of time for my bubble to relax. So my bubble has a relaxation time that is much, much shorter than the period of my wave. That means I can treat formation of bubble, grow and collapse separately without to being disturbed by the wave. I am using constant pressure simulation to locate the pressure that is giving me the formation of the bubble barrierless. I will explain later that. Once I know where in the phase space I can get the bubble, then I switch to constant volume simulation because I want to study the growing, the structure, and everything of the bubble. And then I switch again to a constant pressure simulation when I want to collapse the bubble. So I go from negative pressure to positive pressure, and then I'm squeezing the bubble. I am using also a so-called picture negative approach in the sense that I'm a little bit, so to detect the cluster, so this is a kind of picture for my simulation. The red one are oxygen and the gray one, I'm not sure if you can see, but these are the organic ionic liquids. So after a certain snapshot, I finally get a bubble, and to detect the bubble, I'm using a routine from Gromax that is just filling every empty space with water molecules. So I measure my cluster size in function of the number of water molecules that this routine is putting inside. Then I have my own made code that is calculating the connection between these water molecules. This is because you can have very small cluster that I call flickering instable cluster like this, and a very big bubbles like that. So it's a picture negative in the sense that I count the number of water molecules that the utility is putting me in my trajectory. These are the first results, so this is especially to explain the process. So what I do a series of an MPT simulation, this is for water, and I go down in step of 50 bar from zero to very negative pressure. Why I'm doing that? Because I want to go to the region of the phase space where there is no barrier anymore. I don't have time to wait for the real to go over the barrier. So I'm really breaking the stability. And I do that in a very short time, 100 picoseconds. So here you see that I had to go from, so maybe it's very difficult to read. So I had to go down up to minus 1,400 bar to see something in my volume that was happening. So what's happening if you look at a sample like this, molecularly? So the sample, when you do a constant pressure simulation in this condition, the sample starts to boil and the simulation explodes and crashes. This is a normal standard thing. So basically it's exploding, the volume is too big. So once, but at this point I know the pressure at which this is happening without any barrier. So it's much easier for me to locate at least this stability. I have done the same things for different four cases. So I take a small sample of water, a big sample of water, and then the two ionic liquids of which I have explained you before. So when we do simulation, we usually take a small and a big just to do this kind, this is called size effect. So we want to demonstrate that the sample is enough big to catch all the details of the bulk system. So my small water sample has 80,000 water molecules, my big water sample has 200,000 water molecules that are basically 600,000 atoms, so it's very big. But what is nice and what is also comforting is that I don't have really to go to the very big sample since the transition, since the bubble happens exactly at the same time. That means from a simulation point of view that 800,000 water molecules is already enough, so it's easy to save time. What you see here, when I do the experiment for the two different ionic liquids, so the amphiphilic one and the hydrophilic one, you see that the, why the amphiphilic one is favoring the formation of bubble in the sense that is decreasing, so the free energy is smaller and the surface tension is smaller, and then it's easier to form bubble, and this happens indeed at lower pressure. Higher pressure, sorry, respect to the water. That is my benchmark case. For the hydrophilic case, instead, it happens at very, very low pressures, meaning that is retarding or is unfavoring the cluster formation, let's say. This is a detail of what's happening when I switch to MVT simulation, and I switch to MVT simulation because I want to study the shape of my bubbles. So I'm considering minus P, that is known in thermodynamics as tension, but it's just the opposite of the pressure. So what's happening is I start my simulation from minus 1,300 bar, and at a certain point there is a sudden drop, and then sudden drop then meaning that the bubble is formed, so the pressure is increased, goes up, and there is an equilibration of the bubble, and the simulation MVT will stay like this forever. So if I do a snapshot, I mean, if I do a zoom of this area, this event is not really so sudden like it appears. I mean, Jorgi gave a very nice introduction about the rare events and the sudden movement, and it's a typical like this, but my study is a little bit more lazy than his study, in the sense that I went straight to the barrierless process. But as you can see here, it takes the formation of the bubble, it actually takes around 40 picoseconds. And these are important details for the physics that is behind. And as you can see also, at the beginning, this, I'm speaking about water, at the beginning the cluster is very irregular, and then when it grows and it finally equilibrates, become isotropic. So these are two. These are the volume of the bubble in function of the time. Consider that this, of course, has been scaled in a way that I can see what is the velocity of the bubble in the two samples, and I can say that it's exactly the same. So the process is the same, it's just a bigger, sample. Then, I already told you that Thea is actually impeding the formation, why P44, so the amphiphilic is actually helping to form the bubble earlier. So let's see, let's try to understand a bit if there is some equation that can help me to understand the physics behind that. So before the bubble is forming, I'm using a very simple description. It's the one of the homogeneous liquid, so this is the definition of the bulk. And then there is a kind of equation that is very popular and is quite old, so I was also very surprised that it's valid also for my case, because I am really at the nanometer scale. The diameter of my bubble are very small. So it's the Rayleigh-Plassid equation, and it is an equation of motion, in the sense of studying the evolution of the bubble in the space. And you have the important ingredient of the fluid mass density, the volume of the bubble, the pressure inside the bubble and in the rest of the sample outside. And then you have surface tension and viscosity. So if you consider that the bubble is equilibrated in my NVT simulation, then you have this term that are null, and then this equation really becomes a kind of Laplace equation. And you can really solve numerically if you use experimental values. So this is what I've done. I solved numerically using experimental value of the bulk modulus and of the surface tension with some value that I found consistent with my simulation values. And as you see in this area, before the bubble is formed, everything behave like a standard fluids. So the pressure, while the volume is increasing, the pressure is decreasing. This is total normal. Then there is and you cannot have bubble, of course, in this case. Omega is the volume of the bubble. So once you find a critical point, then there is a bubble that is forming. The bubble then grows linearly in volume, and the pressure goes to a constant value that we call reduced pressure. residual pressure, sorry. And I solve this numerically integrating this equation. MD simulation, I do the same, so I do a series of constant volume simulation, a certain volume, I increase the volume, then I look at the pressure from my lumps, from my Gromach simulation, and I do that in a series of simulations. And I notice that it's a fluid, there is exactly the same shape. So at the beginning is linear, so there is no bubble, and it's the description of a fluid, standard fluid. Well, then there is a bubble, and there is an increase, a linear increase of the number of water molecules that I use. That I use to define the bubble. And then the pressure goes to this value that is called residual pressure. So my simulation in all the three cases, water, ionic liquid one, so hydrophilic and amphiphilic and hydrophobic, gives me exactly the same growing description that the Rayleigh-Plessed equation gives. That is quite surprising since it's a macroscopic equation. It was a nice surprise, let's say. But what is important to see is the look at the phenomenology of the cavity, so the snapshots of the cavity. So this is, I'm using now, this is just a sample of water. I'm using the color blue just to show you the dimension of my bubble. And this is the oxygen colors in general. So in simple water, you have a very isotropic bubble. In TEA, that is the hydrophilic compounds, the hydrophilic compounds get very well distributed in the sample, and the bubble is forming, but you can see that the interface, there are no ionic liquids, so there is maybe the interface is water rich. And the cavity is there. This is the P44 is a completely different case. So we have managed to actually create bubbles that are coronated by ionic liquids. So here it's a little bit by the hydrophobic things. And if we look molecularly at what's going on, is inside the hydrophobic head is inside the cavity, and that hydrophilic tail goes in the water. So it looks like it's coronating, so the ionic liquids are coronating the actual bubble, making the bubble very resistant. So why I do say resistant? Because I have done an experiment, a simulation experiment, squeezing the bubble. So I went in the opposite direction. So I went, I started with an equilibrated bubble at a certain volume, and I squeezed it. So I changed of 3% to see what the pressure was doing and what the volume of my bubble was doing. So for TEA and for water, so for the hydrophilic compounds and for the water, I get exactly the same trend that I was getting from the Rayleigh-Plessed equation. Means that the trend is completely reversible. For the third case, I have a surprising competition between the interfacial superficial energy tension, and the elasticity around the fluid. What does it mean? If you notice here, if you push the volume, if you change the volume of your simulation, you push your simulation, the bubble will disappear at a certain volume that is different than zero. Here, push it very hard, it looks like I have a glassy, very resistant material, and the life of the bubble is very, very long, in the sense that it is quite difficult to kill the bubble and to implode the bubble. So what are the applications? It's very, So I was looking for something else, honestly. I was trying to get a lot of energy from my implosion. I didn't manage it, but I think it's a matter of size. Size matters, so these are my nanometer bubble and I need a micro size, So basically this is a movie from one of the bubble that is growing in the picture negative things. The next stage will be to go to coarse grain or to serious simulation like Georgi is doing. Thank you.